super bien, ça.
Ah ouais,
là. Moi, t'as pas deux minutes, là?
Non.
In my verb, to me, is part of a process of reinvention of how I approach cinema. It was the first time I used some improvisation.
Maggie, can you come with me now? Yes.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. C'est bon?
It was the opportunity to experiment in areas that I had never really experimented before.
C'est bon? Mm-hmm.
And also having fun in the process. It's never happened to me to actually laugh watching what I was shooting, you know, or having just plain simple fun at shooting something that had the kind of energy comedies have. And we were shooting it so fast. So it was a pleasure, and it was also some sort of reinvention of what my filmmaking can be or could be or should be. Before Irma Vert, the opportunity came to make a movie called Cold Water, which was a turning point. And it was both the fact that my previous film, A New Life, was a box office disaster. Press did not like it. I'm still very happy I did it, but I didn't feel I was exactly where I should be at in terms of my work. And Cold Water was obviously a complete departure from everything I had done, in the sense that it was shot on Super 16 with no stars, meaning it was teenagers, it was semi-autobiographical.
Ça va, y a pas que moi. Hein. J'en ai marre d'être le bouc émissaire. Alors maintenant, on le fait une lettre. J'ai rien fait. Qu'est-ce que j'ai fait encore? Ras-le-bol.
And it was such a modest project, and I even envisioned it as something experimental. Cold Water was the opposite of A New Life, meaning it was much loved and acclaimed, and it was my first movie shown in official, it was not official competition in Cannes, but it was Un Certain Regard, which was very prestigious. And it was really the first time international critics became aware of my work. And after Cold Water, I had another bigger project, which was a period piece, Les Destinées Sentimentales. It was on such a grand scale, and it started in the 1900s. It ended in the mid-30s, so it's different periods, locations all over Europe. But then it kept on being pushed back. And one day I just sat down and I should do something with that time. I mean, you know, I can't just sit there waiting for that movie to happen. And Irma Vert started. It was an idea Claire Denis had, and that she brought to me, and then I brought in an Atomic Oyen. The idea was to make a movie in three parts, which dealt with three rooms of the same Paris hotel. And in each room, you had a character which belonged to one of the three stories. So Claire started working on her project. I started working on my project. And then I happened to be in the jury in the Venice Film Festival. And that was the year Wong Kar-wai was showing Ashes of Time. And Maggie Cheung was there. And I was just plain amazed by Maggie. I mean, beyond the fact that I was not aware that I was just plain and simply falling in love with a person, what fascinated me is that she was a movie star in a culture where being a movie star was something that we have forgotten about in the Western world. She was worshipped. And the thing is that she was Chinese, but she was also Western. And she didn't belong to that culture at all, because Maggie grew up in England. I mean, basically, she's a British kid who came back in her late teens in Hong Kong to do some kind of beauty pageant and became a reluctant movie star in many ways. And she was so incredibly modern. She was, you know, involved with the most modern filmmaker of that time, who was Wong Kar-wai. And at that point, I never really imagined that I would ever make a movie with Maggie. But I kind of wondered, what kind of movie would I have made if I had functioned in an environment where you have movie star? Would I have done Joseph von Sternberg? All of a sudden, you start fantasizing about what movies are, what they mean to you, and what you have loved also through your time being watching films.
Alors, Maggie Chung, 1.
I mean, it's fun working with Jackie, too. It's completely different.
So I kind of stuck with this idea. And when I had time to sit down and just scribble a few notes on the hotel project, what popped up was Chinese movie star. Chinese movie star comes to Paris. And then what? I don't know. And I started writing and it just kind of, you know, just it just took shape so fast in such an obvious way. And at one point, I realized that Claire was working on something else. Atom was working on something else. Ultimately, Claire's project became Trouble Every Day. She made it a few years later. And all of a sudden, instead of writing 30 pages for a short film, I wrote a short feature, which ended up being a regular size feature, actually. And I had this moment when I could make the film before being absorbed by the preparation of the big movie coming up. And emboldened by the experience of Cold Water, in like 10 days, I wrote something that within the context of French film production at that time was crazy. I imagined it as a very experimental project, and I was right. I mean, no one wanted it. They kind of just laughed at us. How can you imagine we are going to finance this crazy movie? And luckily, the producer I was working with at that time, Georges Benayoun, who also produced Cold Water, had some kind of friendly relationship with the guys who were buying movies for Canal Plus. And then they said, we can give you like the minimum, you know, and they gave us the minimum they would give for a French film. And that's all the money we had, and that was it. So we shot it in 4 weeks, the crew being only paid 3 weeks, the fourth week being an investment. We ended up paying the fourth week, but after the film became successful, the whole thing was a very happy story because it was very adventurous because, you know, no one was expecting us. The film was shot in Super 16. We were shooting with this Chinese superstar. You know, she was both a superstar, but at the same time, no one knew about her. You know, we had to explain. This lady is actually really famous in Hong Kong. And it's actually using Maggie in Irma Vep, meaning shooting someone who is playing herself, that made me question the status of the movie star or the status of the actor.
This is why. This is the reason. You understand what I say?
At Irma Vep, I've always seen it as some kind of process of reconciliation with filmmaking, in the sense that right after Irma Vep, I made a documentary on Hou Hsiao-hsien called the HHH Portrait of Hou Hsiao-hsien, which was a way of having some sort of dialogue about the situation of cinema at that time with someone who happens to be a friend and who happens to be one of the greatest filmmakers of that time. But it was a way of exploring what cinema could be, should be, and how somehow to go back to filmmaking, but after some kind of soul searching. At the same period, right between shooting Irma Vep and shooting the documentary on Hou Hsiao-hsien, I wrote an essay on the movies of Kenneth Anger, which was also very important because it was a way of reconsidering my relationship with actors. You know, Kenneth Anger has this really fascinating notion of actors being more like souls, being more like forces and carrying within their inner self, something that connects them to magical forces.
La bouche pour les yeux.
Ah, mais c'est un cuir.
Meaning that you have to go and look for the invisible vibes that the specific actor has and that belongs only to him. After that, that person can represent things, you know, scenes you have written and this and that. But his own identity, his own individuality must come first. So Imhotep, Hoshao Shen, Kenneth Anger, it's a turning point for me. And I like the idea of connecting a movie star coming from another culture to this archetype of international filmmaking and all the various versions of that character that have been haunting the history of cinema.
Well, it's just completely different from what I imagined, you know.
No, no, no. Look at the photo he gave me. This is the idea of Imhotep.
And Imhotep, she was the first one. And if we remember the vampires, it's because of her. I mean, we remember it because of Feuillade and so on and so forth. But I think it would be another serial if there was not this fantastic creation that is more like a ghost that has been invoked as in a magical ritual and has never left filmmaking. Louis Aragon, the famous surrealist French writer, wrote about her, and he says two very interesting and fascinating things. One is that this movie was shot during the First World War. So a lot of the kids who were on the front and who would have a break for a couple of weeks of being in the trenches flocked to watch the episode of the vampires because there was this fascinating sexy fantasy of a heroine that stayed with them until possibly their death on the front. And also, there was something that was completely new in cinema at the time, which was the glamour of evil. Imhotep is a bad girl. She's a murderer, and she gets away with it. And Musidora, who is the actress who plays Imhotep and who is a very fascinating character in her own right, she's very different from any movie star before her. And she became one of the first women directors. She wrote film criticism. She's not just an actress being Imhotep. She's the one who imagined the catsuit. She was very much part of the creation of that character. And it has come back in Hollywood movies. It has come back in international movies. So there was something archetypal about it that fascinated me.
Ça vous fait marrer. Non, non, ça vous fait marrer. 25 prises pour voilà, ça vous fait rire.
But movies about the movies, they are just the toughest movies to make because everybody is going to think you are, you know, just self-centered or you are making movies for the elite. The reaction is instantly negative. Ultimately, if there's one thing that has been consistent in my filmmaking, is always making movies nobody wanted or expected or whatever.
Ich hab dir doch gestern die ganze Szene erklärt. Ich hab dir doch ganz genau gesagt, wie alles ablaufen muss. Ich begreife überhaupt nicht, warum hier nichts aufgebaut ist. Sascha!
Was ist denn?
Warum ist denn hier überhaupt noch nichts aufgebaut?
Das stimmt. Du hast mir zwar was erklärt, aber... Aber du musst doch entscheiden, wo genau die Fahrt gemacht werden
muss. Muss ich denn alles alleine machen? Wenn ihr nicht mal selbst was entscheidet, werdet ihr auch nie Spaß an eurer Arbeit haben. Bau sie halt hier auf!
Okay. I think that Beware of the Holy Whore is the best movie made about independent filmmaking. It's hugely influential. And what I was interested in is the honesty of Fassbinder when he's representing the film crew and the hardships of doing those kind of films. When I made Imhotep, I was constantly bombarded with press asking me, so obviously this is your Day for Night. And, you know, and Day for Night didn't even cross my mind. Irma Webb has nothing to do with Day for Night, because Day for Night is a fantasized version of what cinema is. It's seen through the eyes of François Truffaut as a child. It's the way he imagined, he dreamt about movies before he started actually making movies. But what I was trying to do is to capture something that is very specific and that has to do with European independent film culture.
Excuse-moi, mais pourquoi tu lui racontes ça? Elle est sous hypnose pendant toute la scène.
Je sais pas, j'ai l'impression que c'est important. C'est bien d'assister. D'ailleurs, je suis pas sûr qu'elle comprenne tout ce que je lui dis. Tu crois qu'elle comprend?
Oh merde, vous pouvez pas aller fumer ailleurs. C'est la troisième fois que je vous le demande. C'est quand même pas compliqué, non?
Fumer ailleurs, hein?
Ouais,
bon tour.
Ouais, c'est pas.
Irma Webb is a movie about chaos, in a sense that you are on a set, you're working with people who have different histories, who all of them completely different relationship with the medium, who come from different places, and you think you're speaking the same language, but ultimately you're not. Ultimately, each person has a different angle.
The vampires.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Maybe it would be good, I don't know. Maybe, I say maybe, but... Mm-hmm. You know, what's the point? Why do we do what's already been done? Why don't we do more personal films? Mm-hmm. You don't think so?
For instance, you don't understand the character of Zoe. If you don't think of her as connected to that form of radical leftism.
Political. They did politics, but now they don't do politics anymore.
Yeah, so but we're much shame. Better right now, I can tell you.
For me, most of the people I've been working with, my colleagues, collaborators, friends, come from militant filmmaking, because that was the 70s, and they were trying to do movies similar to Place de Lutte, in a way or another. But they developed an idea of cinema that was very specific to that period, and it has certainly changed the way we make movies, the way we see movies, and so on. But when I was making Irma Webb in the mid-90s, those movies were 20, 25 years old, and obviously the guys who had made them had changed with the times. And those movies stay only as some kind of ghost presence in French cinema. But to me, they were part of the kaleidoscope of film that I wanted to represent in Irma Webb. But Irma Webb is a movie about film theory. It's a film about ideas I care about. And somehow it was important for me to reconcile with the very different person I was when I was writing for Cahiers du Cinéma in the 1980s. I mean, I never really wanted to be a film critic. You know, I wrote in the Cahiers du Cinéma because very famous filmmakers had been writing for Cahiers du Cinéma before me, and I thought it was a good opportunity to get into filmmaking, meaning direct movies. So when I started making films, I kind of rejected that past. You know, I said, you know, I'm a filmmaker now. You know, yes, for a while I wrote about movies, but it's not important. What's important is the movies I'm making. And I'm a filmmaker, and please just stop asking me how it feels, you know, being a film critic and filmmaker. But when I made Irma Webb, it was a way of reconnecting with the part of me that had been involved in film history, that has been involved in the film criticism. And yes, I had been hugely influenced by the Chinese films I had seen at that time. Yes, militant filmmaking has meant something for me. Yes, I had been influenced by a lot of movies from the silent era.
T'as vu les vampires?
Oui, j'ai vu deux épisodes justement, et heureusement qu'il y avait la vitesse accélérée. On en a vite fait le tour.
Bah, c'est du roman feuilleton. Il y a une poésie du genre, il faut le prendre comme tel.
The beauty of silent cinema for me has always been the fact that every single filmmaker was trying for the first time to represent something that had not been represented using that medium. And there is something so virginal, so pure, so magical that you can't really recreate. You know, I'm some sort of cinephile in the sense that I've seen a lot of movies and I've been inspired by a lot of films. But ultimately, when I make my own movies, I'm trying not to be a cinephile. So how do you recreate the magic of the silent era? How do you recreate this sense that things are happening for the first time in front of your camera? You know, I saw Maggie as the soul of cinema, as a thing of beauty, which is in connection with the most beautiful things that art can achieve. She's like a conduit. We were discussing earlier Kenneth Anger. I mean, to me, Jean-Pierre Léo is like a shaman. He's someone who brings with him forces that are beyond him. He's really someone who is totally in touch with what is most invisible about filmmaking. He believes in the magic of filmmaking.
I am angry with myself. You know, it just imagines no soul, my foot.
And at that time, he was interested in voodoo. And he's really someone who is obsessed with the magical powers of cinema. So having him in a shot is not your usual experience of shooting a film. He brings a quality of concentration, of intensity on the moment he walks on the set.
But it is not because it's silent that you must try to play more. You must play less.
Which has also to do with the fact that in a movie like MFF, you have no idea what he is going to do. The cameraman sometimes was asking me, so what's the shot? You know, the shot is basically record what Jean-Pierre is doing. Let's see where it takes us. So that's one part of it. The other part is I was interested in the idea of someone who was concerned with a way of transcending the experience of filmmaking. Because the character of René Vidal seems completely out of touch. He's famous for movies he has made a while ago. During the whole film, you believe that he's sending this project into a dead end. You think that he's asking himself big questions that do not have answers. But when the film finishes, all of a sudden, you see that whatever it is that you're watching and that he has created, which is the purely experimental last scene, you realize that, well, maybe he had a point. Maybe something is happening there that's transcending the whole idea of filmmaking. And so I always considered that MFF was the movie that had the happiest ending of all the movies I've made in a certain way. And in terms of when I was trying to think of the shape and form of the experimental film at the end, I thought I liked the idea of using something that the letterists had done. I had discovered Of Venom and Eternity and was really impressed by the film. And I thought there was some kind of punk rock violence in the scratching, in the way, in the aggression against the texture of cinema.
Of course. Well, because you know she...
And MFF was the first time I worked on an Avid. You know, all my previous films I had done on the old school analog. When we were editing MFF, it was very exciting because it was a completely new method. You know, I was working with my editor, Luc Barnier. And we realized we could do things we would never have been able to do before that. So the film was, of course, shot in Super 16.
It's okay with me. I don't care.
The black and white scenes with Maggie were shot with a silent 35mm camera. I gave them to a guy who had been doing scratching and experimental movies in France. And he sent us back some of the stuff he has been doing, and we mixed the shots we had done, the scratching, some stuff we reversed, sometimes we superimposed, we saturated, exaggerated the brightness. We did a million things. But also, I liked the idea to have the same experimental approach to the sound as we had to the images. We just sampled sound left and right, and we recreated some kind of nine-inch nails type stuff. And we used some techno, that because we had one of the sound editors who was a guy who was doing that kind of music, so we used some of his stuff. I mean, we had very little money, you know. And Irma Webb had releases all over the world, and with Maggie we traveled a lot. And yes, it just made me realize that I had a form of inspiration, I had a way of imagining modern cinema or independent cinema in ways that were closer to international filmmaking than to insular French filmmaking. I've always been fascinated by the inner workings of cinema, the way movies transcend reality. They are always documentary in a way or another, but also they are in touch with something that is invisible. That in a sense, and when you walk out, you remember movies as what the movies actually is, but also as the experience of the image it has inspired you while you were watching it. The way a movie connects with an audience is the way the audience fills in the blanks, and movies need blanks. I am deeply convinced of that, because it's the space you give to your audience to appropriate the film and transform it in a certain way to suit their own imagination, their own desire, their own fantasies, as opposed to the general idea that the audience wants to be passive. I think there is no art when the audience is passive. I think there is art only when there is a dialogue between the work of art and yourself. I think the artist I admire the most is David Hockney, because he is able to represent a vase with flowers and make it an incredibly modern work of art, and at the same time have a reflection on the painting, on the history of painting, on the history of optics, and also a discourse on the history of art. And I would like in movies to be in that kind of position. And I have faith in cinema. I have faith in the medium profoundly. I don't have a single doubt.
Ça vous a plu, hein?